IIT Rajasthan. Dr. Vijay's expertise lies in machine learning and data science. Before this, he was a manager derivative in quantitative finance in Singapore. He has published multitude of papers in international journals and is a PhD in statistics from IIT Mumbai. He has co-authored a book titled Systems Thinking Approach for Social Problems. He is a recipient of Best Faculty Award from IIT Jodhpur. Please give a round of applause to Dr.
When I started working in Singtel, was a quantitative finance unit in Mumbai. So there we figured out that regression is most useful phenomena in industry, because there, and particularly when we were talking about finance and finding out relationships among parameters. So this was very good tool to use, and from there I started using regression and learning about machine learning more from there. So it was in 2008 we built the first econometric model with RBI, and it was particularly on operational risk aspect. And so currently I'm working in different fields of prediction. One direction is finance. There we're trying to predict short-term market behavior, and on the other side we're predicting also solar radiation. So two different directions, but for me these are tools which I am using for any set of data. So that is what I'm trying to demonstrate, that for any set of data when you need to build a relationship, how will you build. And this is the recent work we did in Jodhpur for elderly people. So to say that what we have done over here, we used a very simple model called as regression. I hope you are familiar with regression. How many of you are not familiar with regression? What is regression actually? What do we mean by regression? Maybe theoretically, what do you understand by regression?
Predicting something based on the historical regression.
Okay, predicting something, yeah, that is application of regression, that we try to predict something. But let me tell you a technical definition of regression, being a statistician, and that will be very helpful. Yesterday we were talking about Bayesian statistics, and from there it comes that conditional expectation, in technical terminology, conditional expectation is the name of regression. Repeating conditional expectation is the name of regression. What does this mean? That regression is useful. For example, what you were saying, if I applying it in practice, and if I am predicting, let's say, tomorrow temperature at 11 a.m. So that means what I am giving you is a number which I am expecting for tomorrow, given that tomorrow's weather will be this one, this one, this one, this one. So in technical terminology, I can say that this is what I am expecting given these features. So when we talk in terms of machine learning, regression, or we talk in any other terminology, regression is basically the conditional expectation. What you are expecting now. So when we are applying conditional expectation, or when we are applying this as a technical definition, then we need to understand the behavior of the data. And again, coming back to the technical term, this distribution is what the behavior of the data. So you need to understand. So those who understand behavior of the data, that means equivalently we understand the distribution of the data. And the moment we have that, we can easily apply it on our data set, whatever the data set is. Now here, we chose it for an interesting problem. And this problem was to build a model for to predict the muscle power of elderly people. And we wanted to build a model and compare it with the global model. So there was a team of four researchers. One of them was from France, Professor David Gusset. I was from India, and there were two research scholars working, one under me and one under David. So these people started collecting data, and the objective was to build a model which can predict muscle power, and we wanted to compare with the global model, because That was the model we were using in India. So that muscle power model was used in India. A lot of people used to criticize that model because that was built in United States under those conditions. And their conditions and our conditions are slightly different. So we got a different model. How useful this model is, we don't know. This is a recent work. We have just proposed the model. How useful this will be, we are not sure about it because now we are still collecting data. More data will tell us the behavior. Okay. So what this the background of this this data set is? We'll just read that and then we go to the two regression analysis. So aging, this is the problem. What happens when people age? So you know that what can happen. So when I'm talking about aging, it's more than 60 years of age in Western country. In our country, it is more than 65 years of age. So this is how they define it. So functional decline, loss of muscle strength and power. And this is the most important factor, loss of muscle strength and power. So muscle power is what we are trying to predict. That if you have muscle, your muscles have power, probably you can walk, you can also talk in terms of grip strength, and your grips will also much more strengthened. Okay, falling, these are problems with these people. Okay, and these are some of the statistics. So these are global statistics. Aging in world, this is what we started with, that 8.5% is the total number of people. Fall rate in elderly adults, 30-60%. And injury death rate is 10-20%. And regions of fall, globally, these are logical regions of fall. Age, living alone, food problem, visual impairment, and so on. Now, this we compared with some of the statistics in India. Aging in India is almost close to that. And there it was 8.5%, here it is 7.7%. And here the definition is age greater than 60. Prediction of 2050, why we need a model? Because this is the reason. Prediction is 90%, which is more than that of the prediction, the global prediction. So, and levels of fall is currently 47%. Okay, these are some of the functional screening tests we did. So, we conducted these 5 tests in an hospital. We invited a lot of people, these people. And so, first was a very simple test, time, get up and go test. So, these are all how we collect the data. This was primary data, we did not use anyone else's data. So, we ask these people to go for 3 meters and come back again, and then we check the behavior. So this was first test, and then second was one leg test. I'll demonstrate these tests, how these will put that action. These are 5 tests. So this was the first one. We asked them to walk for 3 meters and come back, and noted the time, how much time does it take. A normal person take, how much time a normal person take, that was already noted. So this was first test, very simple one. Then second test was this one leg stance test. We asked them to stand on one leg and we noted the time. So this was done 5 times. We noted first time and then we asked them again after 1 minute and then so this is how it was noted and compared with the. This was balance quality test, BQP test, where we asked them to stand for some time on a smooth surface and noted the time again over here. Then this 5 times sit to stand, they were sitting and we asked them to stand, 5 times sit to stand, noted the time, how much time do they take. So that also shows their grip strength because they have to hold the chair first and then they stand on that. So this was also noted. And this was done for 101 participants. This was really very difficult task for us. Data, getting the data, we are worried about big data, but yeah, here it was, getting the data was a task. You have a lot of data, but anyway, the analysis will remain same. I'm not talking about the data, this was in our environment. We had 25 females and 76 males. So the model building part took half a day, but this data collection part took around 2 months time. So not easy, the application was big and We carefully collected all the data so that we can have a good model. Alright, so 101 participants and then average age was 70 plus minus 5 years. No major medical conditions, so this is the real work we did. And we obtained the ethical approval and so on and so forth. Collected. So these are all for a purpose of sending in. Alright, so these tests were done. All these tests we just collected. And then we started doing the analysis. Then this is how you can start your any analysis on your data. So if you now I'm talking in general. So that was the environment from which the data is collected. Now I'm talking in general how regression is applied. So again, repeating, regression is nothing but conditional expectation. You need to understand the behavior of the data. So now suppose you have one variable and you want to establish a relationship between this with respect to other features. So okay, so there are two things. I don't know whether you're familiar, but just repeating. Yesterday we were discussing that, and there was some confusion, so I'm repeating it. In machine learning, especially when we talk about supervised learning, in machine learning you have famously used two different kind of learnings. One is supervised, another one is unsupervised. It's not exhaustive. I mean, you have reinforcement learning and semi-supervised and so on so forth. But yes, these are two famous, supervised and unsupervised. In supervised also, we have two tasks. One to be used for qualitative data, another to be used on quantitative data set. So when we talk about quantitative data set, this is what is regression. So whatever you do, whether it is the use of artificial neural network, whether it is the use of linear model, whether it is the use of non-linear model, these are all, whenever we talk about quantitative phenomena, it is all regression. And whenever we talk about regression, again coming back to the definition, that means we are talking about conditional expectation. What is my expected temperature given all these parameters? This is what we are talking about. So if we know more about the behavior of features, we will be able to understand more. Anyway, so the first analysis is very simple. Over here, there is a big mindset, but yeah, descriptive analysis is what you can start with. And descriptive analysis means you just need to know about the data. How good, what is the average value of when we talk in terms of time, what is the average time of central state, for example, in this case. Whether the data is okay. Again, this is very important that we violate some of these assumptions by using regression. This has to be kept in mind. That regression, when we go for linear regression or any other generalized linear model, one more myth, I don't know whether you have this in your mind, but when I use two models, for example, one is I need a relationship between height and weight, for example. And you have a relationship like weight is equal to a plus b into height. We call it as linear model. If this relationship is given by a plus b into height plus c into height square, what do we call it? Is this a quadratic model? So if I write y equal to w equal to the weight equal to a times e raised to the power height, what do you call it? This is again a linear model. This is not a non-linear model. This is again a linear model, generalized linear model. You can write it in terms of, so linear when we talk about, it is with respect to the parameters. It's a way that we use the term non-linear model for such a model which is actually linear. And this is very important to understand that whenever we are using these linear models, the underlying assumptions are very important. And one of the underlying assumptions is normality, that the data should follow normal distribution. That's what the first assumption is all about. If it does not follow normal distribution, linear model is not guaranteed. Alright. On the other hand, I mean this is a very important technical assumption. On the other hand, if the data follows normal distribution, then there cannot be any other relationship, but the relationship has to be linear. If normality, then it is linear. If linear, then the underlying assumption is normal. For normal distribution, for multivariate normal distribution, we have this as a mathematical result that the data will always follow linear relationship. There cannot be any other possibility of a relationship. And there only, so this is important assumption, if we can check it, that if we are sure about it that the data follow normal distribution, then you can go for correlation, then you can go for linearity. And these things will make sense while talking about the relationship of the dependent. If it is not normal, then there is a problem. There are different definitions. a measure of dependence in that case. Anyway, so these things will make sense in that case. How do we check the normality assumption? We have a lot of non-parametric tests such as spin row test, and QQ plot, PQ plot, and so on. Some graphical methods. Okay. Sometimes we do not have big data set. So when we have a small data set, this is a good technique to increase the data set, statistical technique, which is called as bagging. So what in this technique, what we do is sampling without replacement, very simple way of increasing the data set. So suppose you have this much data in your set, wide data point, and particularly case like this, when we go for medical records, the data set is not big. So in that case, we go for sampling without replacement, which is what is called as bagging. So in this, we just draw few elements and then put them back from the same sample. So this is how it works. So, you can take multiple samples in that case. And this is very useful. So in the earlier case, when we were using only one sample for decision analysis, the decision tree was very efficient method. And the decision tree has now become random for us by using this bagging. You have multiple samples, and from the same sample, you're just creating photographs of the same sample, and then when you're using them, you have different decision trees, and all these trees put together will form a forest. So that has become a very efficient technique for classification. For regression also, you can increase this size of that. And then, especially when you have a small data set, you can also go for cross validation. This you can read about. Just fix. Let's say you have k data points, you take some s number of data points out from it, and for the remaining part, you can consider the remaining part as a training set and this part as a test set, and then keep rotating it. So pick another s, use it as a test set. So this is how you can do this cross validation part. Now finally, taking the way. Yeah.
Like in your case, we have a huge data set.
In my case, I do not have it.
Let's say general scenario. Yeah. We have a huge data set where we are calculating the muscle strength of a person depending upon the age. There could be other factors as well as the sex and the weight, body weight, height, etc., which would be used to calculate that these are the parameters which will be helpful to me to determine what will be the muscle strength. So how would you or me be able to identify that these are the particular factors which would be able to give me or predict the muscle strength of a person? How could you identify those particular factors from a huge data set?
Yeah, that's where the experience is necessary. If I am not from the domain, if I do not know what muscle power will be function of, so I do not know these features, what these features would be. So then there is no way to obtain the data. And if you do not obtain the data, if you do not know how to obtain the data, there is no way that statistics will be useful. We have to go into that domain to understand. So for example, if we talk about, let's say, financial analysis, what the market will depend upon. If I do not know that, then what data will I collect? And if I don't collect data, then statistics will not tell. So here, there is no model which tells you what kind of features will be important for this particular response. No, that statistics will not tell. Those features, you have to yourself identify those features. So for example, when we are talking about, let's say, the interest rate in India, what it is function of. So maybe you can consider. Sometimes these features are not, there is no exhaustive list of these features by the way. So for example, if you are interested in finding out interest rate in India, predicting interest rate in India, short term interest rate. So then you will write interest rate as a function of some features. Now what those features will be? So your experience might say that, okay, you can consider inflation. You may consider Sensex. Okay, BSE, NSE, you may consider dollar versus rupee rate. So these are the factors, but these factors will come from your experience only. You may even consider, somebody may say, next year we have election, so the scenario is different. So you might consider that as a parameter, how far the election is. So maybe you can give 0 and 1. Alright, and again, when you're talking about it, what is the behavior of RBI? So these are the features which will come from the experience, not from the statistics.
So does statistics does not help us to find a particular pattern from a huge data set? From if I apply a statistics on a huge data set, and I be able to fetch a particular pattern from that set of data, which will tell, okay, these are the particular factors which is implementing.
Yes, certainly. So okay. So if you have, let's say, 1,000 such features, or let's talk 100 such features, and you want to predict one variable based on these features. Now you want to understand which features are more important and which features are less important. Yes, statistics helps that. So we call it as, particularly in case of regression, we call it as F-test. Okay, that F-test will tell you whether you can remove a particular feature from the analysis itself or not. So there are two ways to do it, this. And these are two logical ways. So how do you start? So Y versus first variable. Y is your response. Okay, so this versus first variable. Then you include the second variable, then you include the third variable. How much its information is useful to predict Y, that will be given by what is called as a technical term, R square. R square is, we call it as coefficient of determination. So that will tell you how much variation of Y is captured by these variables which you are using over. So this is one technique, that you are moving from less number of features to more number of features. Alright? So if you feel that no, it is not giving much input, you leave it. If you feel that it is giving much input, you take it. Alright? So this is one way. Coming from there to here is also a possibility. Same thing can be used over there. You start with 100, compare with 99. So there are two models now, one with 100, one with 99. And you are comparing these two models. Now, we compare these two models, and these two models are giving the same accuracy. So that means what? So logically that means that 100 feature is not very important. Alright, so if it is not important, leave it. So similarly, then we have come to 99. Now remove one more. And then, so this is how we can remove the feature. Also, so this is in regression. Also, we have a lot of other criteria for reduction. When you talk about feature reduction, we have principal component analysis, we have what is called as feature discriminant analysis. Lot of statistical techniques are available. For categorical variables, we call it as collapsibility, when you can collapse some of these features. So there are tools available. But again, coming back to that, there is no statistical tool which will tell you that while predicting the rate of interest, you need to go to inflation. No, there is no statistical. Okay, so that's about I hope. Alright, so now these were some simple models. Go back to the previous analysis. So Takai was one, and there were two models actually. Takai's model was a kind of deterministic model. It was a physical phenomena, but he used to again predict the muscle power, but he used a deterministic model, physical scenario. And then next was SPIP model. So this was our motivation. SPIP used a very simple model. If you look at it, this is what the global model people use. And this was a very simple regression model. If you look at it, this equation, y equal to v naught plus v1 x1 plus v2 x2. This is a simple linear regression model in which he used four features, x1, x2, x3, x4, number of states, weight of that person, x3 was female length, and x4 was gender. That's it. These four features he used. And finally, he concluded that x3 and x4 do not contribute significantly. So this was the question you were asking. So he started with four features, and then there he saw that after removing x3 and x4, the response y is not really changing much. So that means x3 and x4, so we say that x3 and x4, for us they are two features, but it is important that human length and gender will not make any difference. Whether it is female or male. So this is a very important model.
So people, what is LM
and Y? Y is over here in this case. So I have written the definition of X1, X2, X3, X4. Y is muscle power.
What is error?
Okay, that error, I'll come to that. Now what is the meaning of error? Okay, so I told you that whatever we are writing on the right hand side, other than error, This is what is called as conditional expectation of y. Now, what is error? So, error is when I say tomorrow the expected temperature is 40 degree at 11 a.m. But tomorrow at 11 a.m. when you see actually the temperature is, it may not be 40, so it may be 41 degree. So, the difference between the actual data and the predicted data is what is error. This is what we are predicting by coming based on our inputs. And the actual data will may be something different. So that is what is the difference between, we call it as residual. And this is the most important part, by the way. Statistics does not produce any predictive model. We call it as predictive model. Statistics only is helpful in talking about the error. We try to build a model which is corresponding to the minimum error. We only try to minimize the error. So we play with the error, not with the model. Okay, so we try to minimize the error, optimize the error, is per our choice. So whenever we use these features or their functions, then we just try to minimize the last part, which is residual. And therefore it is important to understand the behavior of error, which is what the next slide. So what the model we used was this one. For us, it was 5 features, not 4 what Smith used, but these were our 5 features. They told you we collected for 101, and then we used this simple model. But this did not work well. I mean, what we wanted to achieve 75% accuracy at least, and that was the achievement of Smith model. So we tried this one, a very simple linear regression model. And when we tried this, what regression does? Least square or any other gradient descent pattern that you use, it fits these values. So d0, d1, these are parameters, their values, the data can be used to estimate these values. Okay, so what we obtained was this one. Okay, now, maybe when we try any of these models in any of these softwares such as R or Python, MATLAB or so then you can get not only that equation but also these quantities, R square, F statistic, P value. So this P value should be low for a good model. And this R square, this is what I was talking about. This R square is the quantity which tells you how good your model is. So what it says actually, its interpretation is this one, that 75%, almost 75% of the variability in muscle power is captured by those features. This is what it says. If you use in this manner, then 75% of the variability is captured by these. Variability is the behavior. So if it is captured by these parameters, we thought 75% is slightly low, because this is what we wanted to achieve. And when we want to achieve 75, it should be more than that with respect to this. And then we tried different model. And how did we try it? So we again now. Now we plotted y versus x1, y versus x2, y versus x3, and there we observed that x3, particularly STS, sit2 state, was not behaving linearly with muscle power. So that was behaving in a quadratic manner. So we then changed our model to the next one. Okay, I'll come back to this. And this was the actual model we did. That x3 square when we used over there, then we obtained that R square value is coming close to 80%, 0.79, and that was sufficient. We just compared with the Smith model, and this is what we want to propose. But before proposing, we are also collecting data from different cities. That data was from Jodhpur city. Now we are collecting from different cities in India, and then we'll just see. We'll compare the model. This is important. Somebody was asking about error. Somebody was asking about error term. That error term is residual term, and that error term has to follow these assumptions. These assumptions can be changed. Finally, when you say that you have built a model for your whatever response it is, then you have to check all these things. The error term is corresponding to value. If you do everything in the spreadsheet, you will have a column where those numbers will be written, and you can check these three assumptions. They should follow normal distribution, all the errors, they should follow normal distribution.
One last question. Like in your case, you have used a data set of 100 people. So, is there a, how did you determine prediction model which you are giving is the accurate one. Let's say if I am doing a prediction on 5 people, how will I ensure that my model is the perfect?
Yeah, I understand. So these regression models are built on the assumption of normal distribution, where there is a result called a central limit theorem, which says that minimum 30 data points should be there to assume that the distribution is normal. Minimum 30. I mean, though 30 is very less number.
Does your prediction model is affected by the size of the data? If you are performing,
if you are performing
your prediction on the, let's say, 1,000 people,
yes,
will your result vary from what you have got it from the 100 people?
Yes. This is definitely vary, and this is very clear. I mean, when we talk about model, we try to capture the variability. Now, when you talk to more people, your model will be able to capture more variability.
Yes.
So your model will be more efficient in that case. So more data will definitely. These 100 people were representative of the population. Now you have 1,000 people as representative of the population. So of course this representation is better. Obviously. Alright. So okay. Maybe I'll just finish it. So these assumptions were important. You can just draw it and you can get it. So these were our conclusions. I mean, some behaviors were linear, some were non-linear, and we'll extend this, we'll try to capture more data. Okay, thank you.
And after you find it, where you share your mail ID, you know, these guys have some doubts.
Yeah.
Maybe you can share that.
So, I don't know.
You can just type on that.
They don't write. Yeah.
You can just type on that.
Yeah.
On the slide.
Yeah.
All right, thank you so much.